2% in this building here. We're not sure what that means. I won't know till Monday. I may not even know then. But we may have to do a little more to this building before we can go. This building is quarantined. It is closed. Please don't go in there and try to look around. It's quarantined because of the asbestos abatement. But we're doing everything we can. We have everybody in place. Our plumber came on Monday morning, and we have water in all the buildings, and it's in the pipes and not on the floors. So that's good. Now, I'll tell you what. We've had our plague and are still suffering from it. We had our flood, and this morning, a little mosquito peeked in. I said he's looking for Melissa in my car. And I saw the first mosquito of spring, so we've had our nets. I'm not looking forward to the frogs nor the flies.
No, my biblical
reference there. We have more announcements. I may have a few more things to say at this time, but right now I'm going to turn it over to Miss Gina. And again, we are trying to go as quickly as we can. Here's Miss Gina.
Good morning. Heard all about the flood and the things that happened in the student building. So we are taking up a collection, if you feel so led to donate. Over here, there's a red apple. It's for the preschool teachers. It's not for the building. It's for the teachers who lost lots of manipulatives, books, things in their classroom, story Bibles, all sorts of school supplies, things like that, just to replenish the things that they lost in their classroom. Because you know, preschool, everybody's down here, everybody in the preschool building, everything is down here where all the water is. So they've lost a lot of things and they'll have to replace some. So if you feel so led to put a donation in there, we'd appreciate it. Then also we have purple little organza bags over here at the front and the back. Those are our Lenten prayer kits that the Lord's Army put together. That they're for anybody in the church who would like to join together with us and make a new prayer ritual for you and your family as we go through the season of Lent. And we'll do that during children's time so you can see how that works. Well, good
Good morning. I have two quick announcements for us. First and foremost, we will be having youth tonight in the Family Life Center at 5 o'clock. We'll have a mission project and then a quick mini lesson. Since we missed a couple, I want to make sure to get some Bible study in there. Second thing is, I wanted to make sure our congregation was aware we have officially started our confirmation class for this semester. So right now we have 6 students going through that class, and we want to make sure that, you know, our congregation is praying for them and helping to support them through all of this. I also have a couple different opportunities for volunteering, so if you feel led to help us out, be sure to talk to me about that. That's all I have.
Good morning. For those that don't know me, I'm Doug Wilson, and I am the chair of the Finance Committee here at the church. And as promised, we're going to talk about 2020, a little bit of hindsight here. We want to thank you all for your financial support through a very difficult year, and as we've seen, 2021 has its own opportunities. We kept the doors open, and we focused on community worship service with our giving. Some of the highlights from last year. Congregational giving was strong throughout the year, and in fact, tithes and offerings were more from this church than everything we brought in 2019. That's the first one. It gets better. Y'all have been great. We were up by 6% overall in income. The big thing is our giving to outside agencies through our mission fund, you know, including the food bank, the school district's project hygiene, and supplies for the Corny schools. Cash contributions were up by almost 3 times. So we did a great job with that. And when you throw in the in-kind contributions, which we didn't track and normally don't track on the Finance Committee, it was an amazing effort by this, you know, outreach to the greater community. Downside, building operations were 24% higher last year than they were in 2019. Of course, we had a major plumbing upset. We had a fire in the sanctuary air conditioner, our heater last year that we had to replace. And there were a few other things that added to that total. Now for the really fantastic news. Ned Bryan loved this church. And he gave generously to the church in his lifetime and in his will. Well, his estate has settled most of its bills and saw fit to give this church a second gift in January of $180,000. That went to paying off the building debt per the way his estate was set up, he requested it. As a result, you know, 10 years ago, we had a half-finished building back there, a roof on this thing that was leaking, and we owed $1.2 million to the bank. January 1st of last year, we owed $391,000 to the bank. As of 3 weeks ago, because I don't know if we've made another payment yet or not, we had a total debt of only $79,000. $79,932. Isn't that awesome? It wasn't just Nan's gift, it was your continued support. So glory be to God for a faithful congregation, Methodists reaching out to the community and taking care of their own business. Thank you.
Doug, I needed that good news after my last week here. It was rough wading through the water. I felt like Moses. I just told you about the plagues, man. Tough stuff.
through your faithfulness, through the faithfulness of members such as Ned and Brian and his family, well, 79,000, 75 now, I think, isn't it? 75 now. I can't believe we've gotten this far. That's just amazing. Thank yourselves. Thank God. Continue to bless us. I believe that, let's make sure I may double here. The children's church will meet over here in the disciple room. Is that correct?
Correct.
And the King's Rangers chancel bells this afternoon here at 3 o'clock for King's Rangers, 4 o'clock for chancel bells. Youth was mentioned this afternoon. The Saturday on April the 17th is the blood drive. Will be here. Last blood drive, we couldn't get into the building, and so we didn't have water, and so they had to go to a motel over here and do the blood drive. But we are able to get back to that now, and we do have water now. Lord's Army next March 3rd, 6:30 p.m. And I believe, Melissa, it's time to worship. Y'all stand for the call to worship, please. The Lord is sovereign. Let the people tremble in awe. Oh, God is enthroned. Here, let me lead you all. God is enthroned upon the cherubim. Let the earth shake. The Lord is great in Zion and high above all peoples. Proclaim the greatness of the Lord our God and worship Yahweh upon the holy mountain.
Our opening medley of hymns this morning, we begin with the great Isaac Watts hymn, O God, Our Help in Ages Past, number 117 in the Methodist hymnal, and we'll segue into El Shaddai.
Was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead.
He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. It is children's time. Children, come up as Miss Jean leads.
Everybody's family in church to have one.
Now, Gina, did you, I didn't hear, I was having a hard time hearing back there. Did you mention that the worship aids that we have here are for all of the families and not just families with children?
Oh, yes. All families, individuals, anybody can take one of the prayer kits. We'd like for our whole church to think about praying for our church, praying during Lent, and adding prayer to every day. You do it already or if you don't, but that's just taking a specific time every day for our church to pray together during Lent.
Thank you, Gina. Children, now remember, please get your parents to help you light the candles and supervise you as you light the candles. Get them to help you with the candles. Don't do it on your own, okay? Chris Craig, you probably need to get Kristen to help you if you know to light the candles. So. You'll need some supervision, Chris.
Always need supervision.
Well, Melissa supervises me, and I don't even ask her to. Does now to present God with his tithes and our offerings. Would the ushers come forward? Let us pray. Lord God, it seems like the world is coming apart at its seams, and yet, Lord, you're still in your heavens, and Jesus is at your right hand. He is interceding in prayer for us each day, and your Holy Spirit has been sent and is available at any moment, at any time, to fill us and aid us in all that we need to do that will glorify you. Thank you for the gifts. We thank you for a very faithful church who's given and taken care of the needs of the community and has reached out in mission and continues to do so. And we pray that you would continue to bless each one here and each family. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, to whom this offering goes in mission and ministry. Amen. May be seated. Well, the COVID virus seems to still be hanging on. Jimmy Pritchett, Baptist preacher, community for years, passed the other day due to the virus. I'm not sure. Does anyone know the details on the funeral? We have sent flowers to them. I don't know any details on the funeral. Is anyone else?
I saw visitation is Friday evening and the funeral is Saturday.
Friday and the funeral is Saturday. Okay, thank you. We'll try to get it. The viewing on 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. If you would just send this to the church and we'll get this out, be good. And that'll be good. If that isn't tough enough, his wife Janet has been taken to the hospital this morning. She apparently had it and it seemed to be somewhat milder. That's the information I'm getting. Please don't hold me to that. Correct me if I'm wrong on that. I'm going by secondhand information. And but she is being rushed. She was rushed to the hospital this morning. And so please keep Janet Pritchett in your prayers today. Please pray for her. In addition to that, we're very sorry to hear that Jimmy Weaver has come down with the COVID-19 and was unable to be here today because he's very ill. And Jimmy's such a leader in our church. We do pray for Jimmy. Carol, I guess our prayers work. You're standing right here. All right. Or sitting here. Prayers for LaDonna Bedford's family, especially for Philip. He is struggling. They had the graveside yesterday. I was with him yesterday, and we had the reception here for their family. And we talked a little. I got a card from her for Christmas, and then I got another card from her right before she got sick, telling how she was going to be glad to come back and see everybody and stuff, and then she came down with her illness. So, but Philip is in need of prayer. I think this has hit him very, very hard. So please pray for Philip Bedford as well. Vanna Duda, any update on Vanna? Any update on her? Her father, Franklin Way, has ongoing health issues, and so we need to pray for Vanna's dad. Lillian, do you want to tell? Hi, Lily. We got you baptized. It's Uncle Bill that I was thinking about, too. I just looked at the deal. This is from last week. So, but your Uncle Bill passed, Heather, and so we do keep you all in our prayers. I know you were close to Uncle Bill, weren't you? And so we need and the whole family. I think there's a very close relation. He was a good guy, from all I understand. So a prayer and prayers for your mom and your dad and so forth. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. I will pray and then we will have a time of silent prayer and we will end with the Lord's prayer. Almighty God, there's so many things to cause us to doubt and to fear. So many things to cause us anxiety each day. So many things to discourage us. So many things have happened to cause us to lose heart, to lose faith, to lose morale. We need the touch of your Spirit, Lord. We need the power of your holiness. We're all tired of this craziness. I think that, Lord, some of it has to do with we need to turn to you. No matter what has happened, no matter what people say about the destruction of the earth, we know that you are still in control. And your Son, Jesus Christ, still sits at your right hand, intervening and intercessing for us. And your Holy Spirit is sent down to us, fills us, and enables us to meet any cause, any challenge, any crisis that might come before us. Thank you for each individual here, for the strong faithfulness of this church. We pray for our church as we build back in our family, our children's center, our student building, and in our sanctuary. Again, we thank you for your graciousness and your love toward us. We pray, Lord, for the Methodist Church as a whole, the United Methodist Church. We face some great challenges before us. Lord, give us peace and assurance that you are still leading us. Let us now turn in silent prayer. Now let us pray the prayer that our Lord Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our hymn of faith is number 415 in the Methodist hymnal, Take Up Thy Cross.
Through his confirmation or bar mitzvah, he stood and read from the scripture. In the Jewish synagogues, after they finished Hebrew school, when they'd gone through their equivalent to confirmation, they stand and they read from the scripture as their first act of entering an adult relationship into the church. Miss Annabelle.
Standing for the reading of the Gospel. Today I will be reading from Mark 8, verses 31 through 38. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders, chief priests and teachers of the law, and he must be killed and after 3 days rise again. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But when Jesus turned and looked at him, come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for a man to gain the whole world, yet forfeit his soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his Father. Glory to the holy angels.
Word of God for the people of God. Amen. Sanibel, thank you for reading from God's Word. I believe this time you all may be seated. I'm casual today. I didn't have my robe. I couldn't find my stole. Everything's wrinkled. It looks awful. The building, if you look on this these pictures, is in, well, it's a catastrophe. It is in shambles. Things are in boxes. We don't know where anything is, and I can't even find my robe closet over there. So, and I'm not supposed to go back into the building either until we get it cleared for asbestos.
Oh,
so.
Excuses, Chris.
If you have any questions at all about any of the building renovation, go to Sam. Try that again. You're losing a step, Chris. I do have a t-shirt my grandson gave me, and I'm going to bring it up and wear it one Sunday. And it says, if I can remember exactly, Melissa, you may help me on this one. Oh, it's Courtney? I thought my grandson gave it. Courtney gave it to me. Oh, my God. Would you tell them what it says? Tell them what it says? I apparently can't remember anything. No, what it says about it, I believe, is be careful what you say. It might be used in a sermon. Is that, did I get it? Pretty much. So I'm casual today, but the Word of God is the Word of God, and shall not perish. Today's passage from Mark chapter 8, beginning with verse 31 and ending with the 38th verse, begins with the words, "And he began to teach." Those few seemingly insignificant words are very significant. It's the way the gospel is. It's the way the Bible is. Words that may not seem to mean much contain a depth of meaning. It says he began to teach. This is a pivotal point, kind of a fulcrum. This is a change not only of direction, but a change in ideas, a change in teachings. Here he begins to teach. In the first part, he was being identified as the Christ. In the second part, he teaches what Christ is to do. He begins in the first part of Mark with the identity of Christ, and now it's the actions of Christ. And it is a new stage in ministry. It really begins a passion story, a passion journey to the cross. This passion journey to the cross is symbolized by the cross before us that our worship committee has so carefully and artistically made to present to us as a teaching aid to help to teach us. The burlap on the bottom is a road. It's the road that leads to the cross. You notice it is uphill, and it is a rocky road. It is the road to passion. It is the road of which Jesus carried his cross, and it is the road upon which all of us are to pick up our crosses and carry it to the place of Calvary. We also notice in this verse that Jesus begins to change. He is changing from especially referring to himself as Son of or Christ to Son of Man. Now, throughout Mark, the word Son of Man is used predominantly when Jesus is speaking of himself. He doesn't necessarily call himself the Christ. Peter does. Christ means the anointed one. But the Son of Man is an image that occurs in Daniel chapter 7. In Daniel chapter 7, we are introduced to this mysterious Son of Man who is a heavenly figure, who is before the Ancient of Days, who we believe to be the God of Heaven Himself, God the Father. And here, this Son of Man who had appeared before the Ancient of Days, who was with God in heaven, is now standing before Peter, looking them in the eye. And again, the Son of Man has a special mission upon the earth. And Jesus is beginning to teach of the purpose and the mission of the Son of Man. In verse 31, Jesus begins to reveal his divine purpose as the Christ, how it is fulfilled. And now he is offering himself up as a divine ransom for the sins of all of us, the sins of men and of women. If you look in Mark chapter 10, verse 45, you will see you will see this reference. Mark here wants to clarify to his readers that the death of Jesus should not be seen as a triumph over opposition. It did not seen as a great military leader coming and conquering another military leader or conquering another nation. Instead of it being a triumph over the opposition, it should be seen as the fulfillment of the divine purpose. It is the fulfillment of God's purpose of redemption upon the earth, a purpose where he comes and Jesus is placed upon the cross, dying for the sins of the world. It is to be welcomed and not wailed. Peter wails what Jesus says when he says that the Son of Man must die. But we are to welcome it because it is the very source of our salvation. Clearly here Jesus presents the essential message of the gospel of Christ. He presents the central message concerning death and resurrection. The central message of salvation. In his preceding passage, Peter makes that wonderful statement. When Jesus asks, who do you say that I am, Peter? He says, you are the Christ. I have read that and read that over and over in my life for more than 35 years, nearly 50 years of my life. I have read that passage over and over and over again, and not quite understood the exact detail of it until about 3 or 4 days ago. I'd understood most of it, but I didn't understand the very detail, one of the great details of it. What Peter is saying is that you are Christ. Peter here is saying, he is indicating he understands the identity of who Jesus is. He understands his identity. You are the Christ. You are the anointed one. You are the one spoken of by the prophets. You are the one sent by God. You are the one sent to save Israel. He understood his identity. But you'll notice that he's rebuked. In verse 32, Peter is rebuked by Jesus. And I have always wondered why was it that he was rebuked. And I figured that he didn't understand the full message. And I was right to a point. I didn't understand what it was about the full message he didn't understand. Because he knew he was the Christ. What he didn't understand was what Jesus was sent to do. He understood his identity. He didn't understand his mission. And I just figured that out about 3 days ago. He was rebuked because when Jesus told him his mission, he tried to distract Jesus, or he said, oh no, you're not going to die. Oh no, we can't have that. Oh, we'll stop that. You know, Peter tried to stop him with a sword. You remember that? He chops off the soldier's ear and tries to stop them. Jesus had to say, we're not going to do that. We don't live by the sword. You know, you live by the die. And it was here that Jesus begins to teach his mission, what he came to do, what he was about, not just who he was. I also think there's a sense here that the devil's like, I don't know, he's just a distraction. Maybe in Sunday school class, maybe in a class you've taught, or maybe a, a Bible class or even a school class you've been in, and someone always seems to interrupt. When things get difficult or hard or tough, someone has a coughing fit. Or someone asks a question that has nothing to do with what anybody is talking about. Like, what's the weather outside? Or, hey, when are we going to quit so we can go eat? I mean, you know, and I think what is happening here is Peter is trying to interrupt or co-opt the plan of God. And I think Satan is influencing him and is trying to co-opt Jesus in his mission. Now, what we need to understand about the devil, we either make too much of the devil or too little of the devil. We need to understand, too, that according to Ephesians, I believe it's the first couple of chapters, we understand that we are sealed by the Holy Spirit. And because we are sealed by the Holy Spirit, it's like the king putting his signet ring on a document. Nobody can break that document except the great king. Melissa and I are married, 1977, that's an eon ago, right? You know, it was a beautiful wedding. It was a wonderful wedding. Her dress was beautiful. She was beautiful. When she got up and it was the crescendo to kiss the bride, I lifted up her veil, I kissed her, and I put the veil back down. You're not supposed to do that. Melissa, I didn't mean it. That wasn't a disapproval, you know. But here in our passage, what we see is that the devil is trying to move things. And the seal of the Spirit is on the Christian. And by saying the seal of the Christian is upon the Christian, only the devil can break that. So we married, I messed up, but we did get the certificate. We still have it, don't we, Melissa? We still have it. She's gonna try to lose it after this. I better stop on my head, right? Remember, you can't break the seal. Only the state of Texas can break the seal on it. There's a seal that only the great king of heaven can break. John Wesley had a signet ring that had his initials in it. And he would put sealing wax on a letter because that's the way you seal the letter. You didn't have glue, so they would put the wax on it and seal it. And the only person that was supposed to break that seal was the person to whom it was sent. The only person that could break the seal of the marriage license that we had says state of Texas is the state of Texas. The only person that can break the seal that God puts upon you is God, or one more powerful than God, and no one is more powerful than God. You are sealed with the Spirit. Therefore, I believe very strongly, because of that, you cannot be demon-possessed. But we can be influenced. The old devil's waiting there. He's waiting there to distract us. He's waiting there to influence us. He's waiting there to kind of get our focus on the right thing. You know, like temptation. My question is we see the, like, what's that movie? TV show. There's a TV show, Temptation Island. Why would any Christian watch Temptation Island? You know, why would we set ourselves up to be tempted? But we do. Many times we see a temptation offered and it kind of tickles our ears and our eyes. Kind of fall to it, and the devil still works that way, but the devil does not possess the Christian. I do not believe here when he says, get behind me, Satan. He is not casting out Satan for Peter. I don't believe that. I believe he is telling Satan to quit interfering with the mission and purpose of the cross. Today's passage, the words, follow me, and the word, if you would follow me, deny, we have to deny ourselves, is used in a very technical sense, to deny oneself. You have to deny oneself and follow me. Take up your cross, deny yourself, follow me. There are three requirements to deny oneself. When used here, it's more than the Lenten practice. You know, at Lent, people give up what? Coffee, Cokes, Diet Cokes in my case, ice cream, wasting time, there are a lot of things we give up. Our friend Don Yeager gave up Brussels sprouts. Well, he was joking. Don's a pastor, retired, but he was joking. But he gave up Brussels sprouts one year. But we're not talking about giving up things in that sense. We're really talking about something greater and more than that. That may be a part of it, but we're talking about something more. That is only a symbol of the greater giving up of what we are to do. That is only a symbol of denying ourselves. It is more than denying our things. It is denying of ourselves, not the things. The focus is on us. It can be our goals, it can be our aspirations, it can be our desires, it can be our dreams. I hear people talking a lot about our dreams, but we all know that if God isn't in the dreams, it's a fruitless endeavor. Mark 10:28 speaks of giving up everything in order to follow Jesus. That includes, more than anything, our attachment to the things. It's our attachments that we have to deny. Deny oneself means to take up the cross and head to the place of the resurrection. Head up the hill to the cross, to the resurrection, to the place of death and the place of life. This isn't referring necessarily to natural suffering, though that may be involved. It talks of the experience of the denying of self, even to the point of death, being willing to even go to martyrdom, not to seek it out, but being willing to give up everything. You notice that Peter and James and John and Andrew all had to give up something when they were called to be disciples. Peter and Andrew gave up a lucrative fishing business. James and John gave up the necessity to take care of their elder father. All of this, leaving it behind in order to follow Jesus. They denied what they were attached to. J.I. Packer, my theology teacher, told us a story, which was in one of his books, about a man who had a very good teaching job at the college, well, the university, and He had come into conflict with the leadership of the school and some of the teachers. And he came into conflict because he wouldn't abandon his teaching and understanding of the gospel of grace. And so finally they let him go. They fired him. They let him go. And when asked about it, he says, "I glory in the fact that I know the Lord Jesus Christ and the gospel of his grace." He was even to deny his own teaching job and all that he had and all that he had attained in his reputation in order to hold on to faith in Jesus. Denying oneself is also repeated day by day. It's a daily affair. We wake up each day to take up the cross. And the cross molds us and shapes us into the image of Jesus the Christ. It is a thing of repetition. It means continuing to the end. It means not losing heart. It means enduring to the end. Now, the word life used here in verse 35 is the word psyche, personality. There's a French word psychonomy, which is bigger than any group of English words that we have to describe. It's a word that only that French word can describe. It's our more of like our essence. Those of you who have more than one child, each child has his or her own essence, do they not? They have something about them that makes them distinctly who they are. It's not giving up so much identity, but it's giving up that essence in the sense that we take on the essence of Christ. We give up our personalities in a sense that we allow Christ to shape and reshape us and remake us. Those who have a you know, before accepting Christ, before I turned 15 and accepted Christ, I knew more cuss words than anybody in this room, I guarantee you. But after I accepted Christ, that changed. That changed, that transformed, that changed. And God can make that change and work that change in any individual, but they first must deny themselves and take up the cross and follow Jesus. Tim Keller says that to come to the cross means to give up one's life in order to do so. And also that it means giving up one's sense of selfhood. And it means giving up those things that give us identity in the world. In the traditionalist culture in the world, families, neighborhoods, towns, nationalities give a person their identities. One stays home for their identity. They source their identity at home. In Texas, it used to be that way. It's still that way more in East Texas than in the cities of Texas. In East Texas, you're still a member of some family, some clan or group. That's kind of that Scottish background, that Scotch-Irish background. And it's where someone would say, well, that's one of those Krager boys, they're all alike. That's one of those Allen kids, they're all alike. I'm not surprised that Ellsworth kid did so well in school. They're all good in school. It's that kind of thing, that idea that our identity comes from the family. That's the traditionalist model. The individual model is more like the U.S. kind of is becoming and kind of is now, in that we gain our individuality, we gain our identity by going outside of the home. We gain it by our usefulness in society. We gain it as to whether we're a good baseball player, good basketball player, good at sports, good at music, good at something. Have one thing that distinguishes us, makes us special. My distinctive mark was I was the fastest kid in Alamo Elementary School. I was the fastest kid until one day, a girl who lived down the street from me, Jan Parker, beat me. I could have lost my whole identity then, except then I raced her again and barely beat her. So, but we tend to base our things on things we can do, things we are good at. That's this individualistic model. But what happens if everything is taken away from us? What happens if we were the fastest kid and all of a sudden we are no longer? It happened to me. I was running one of the fastest running the 100-yard dash in sophomore year. And by the end of my sophomore year, my knees had messed up so bad I couldn't hardly stand up. I could have lost my identity there. There's a young man named Pedro. Pedro was from a family, a self-made family, had a big trucking outfit here in this North Texas. Pedro was the first of the children in his family to go to college. He was accepted at a major university. His cousins and friends decided, let's go celebrate. Pedro bought a new car. I think one of his relatives had actually given it to him, maybe. And they decided to go out. Well, they had too much to drink. One of the cousins decided he would drive. And he ran into a Burger King and killed someone. Pedro's life was over. It was his car, and they couldn't prove that he wasn't driving. The last I knew of Pedro, he was getting ready to go to trial for manslaughter and possibly to be sent to the penitentiary for at least 25 years. I believe that was the sentence. It all ended in an instant. An instant. Our identities in this world can end in an instant. It is only the identity that we have in Jesus Christ that is for eternity. C.S. Lewis says that even if we want to turn to Jesus to get a new identity, still we have to give ourselves to Jesus. We do not find our true selves or true identity, though, if that's what we're looking for. If we're looking for our identity in Christ, we won't find it. because it's our identity we're looking for. We will only find our identity in Christ if we're looking for Christ, if we're looking for Jesus. We have to look for Jesus first before we can find our identity second. Jesus invites you to deny yourself, to pick up your cross and follow him on the journey up the road that leads to the cross. In the name of God the Father, in the name of God the Son, in the name of God the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Our closing hymn this morning is Living for Jesus.
Keep you both today, tomorrow, and always. Amen.